I'm gonna sing my song. It won't take long. Gonna do the twist, and it goes like this.
Hey! You know how some days in the week are just more busy than others? Just as some weeks in the month, some months in the year, some years among others are just more intense than others? Well, some entire decades are that way as well. The 1960s was just such a decade, especially in the U.S. and in larger cities throughout Europe. It was a decade filled with extremes, from diabolic lows marked by numerous assassinations of influential leaders, imprisonments and assaults of civil rights and Vietnam War protesters, to the stratospheric highs of spaceflight, civil rights, and gender equality advances, along with authentic folk music, cool jazz, and awesome rock music. So much happened during this decade. It is easy to lose track of how important dynamics are connected and grew out of prior decades. Fortunately, the arts during the 60s was just as lively as everything else, fascinating in its own right, in addition to being very useful to help remember and connect the socio-political dynamics at work during this decade. This is an English ArtGIBS collaborative VidLes focusing on 1960s art as a reflection of society in the US and Europe, and we'll look at how selected artworks from this era reflect broader societal themes that stand out during this decade. Today, when most young people are asked about the 60s, they think of long-haired hippies talking stoned about free love, which is absolutely accurate, but only towards the end of that decade, which started out completely different. The 60s opened with the US and the Soviet Union, the two largest superpowers on the global bloc after World War II, engaged in a Cold War struggle for global dominance. To understand how the Red Scare threat of communism permeated professional and personal life in the US and Europe, we have to take a quick peek back into the 1950s. McCarthyism and the blacklisting of politically critical professionals in the US had devastated the arts community. Artists such as William Gropper, who produced figurative caricatures of abusive politicians, were denounced as communists and saw their lives and reputations quickly ruined. Figurative painting was also not accepted in the 50s Western art scene for two main reasons. Since the 1930s, the Soviet Union, along with other socialist countries, had been promoting socialist realism, a style that glorified communist ideals. Nazi Germany leaders had also sanctioned a monumental heroic realism, in addition to blacklisting artists whose works were in any way expressionist or abstract. After World War II ended, New York City took over from a destroyed Paris and London as being the center of the art world and promptly held up a new progressive style called abstract expressionism that revolutionized the idea of artworks as being not so much an illustration, rather a non-objective physical documentation of the creative process. Museum curators and art critics loved it, even though most people thought, hey, my little kid can make that. The 1950s is also remembered as a decade of stability, Hollywood glamour, and booming business, all of which were governed by old white men smoking cigarettes who determined what was promoted and thought to be good. During World War II, millions of women had marched into factories to maintain the war industry while the male soldiers were overseas. After the war, the men came back to their jobs and the women came back to their homes pregnant. The baby boomer generation was born, and soon industry shifted from making war items to household appliances for the 50s iconic housewife with a gadget for every domestic need, including that very popular invention capturing the attention of everyone in America, the television, with its free entertainment brought to you by products neatly tailored to the housewife at home and the providing husband at work. Towards the end of the 1950s, popular TV shows both reflected and formed a society identified by white patriarchy, rugged Western manly values, wacky, goofy, yet lovable female stars, and sci-fi thrill. Hollywood placed stars on pedestals for every normal person to aspire to and admire. Yet, as the new decade approached, the heady intoxication that abstract expressionism had once inspired began to fade as other styles began to shine.
That's it.
Color field painting offered a calming, near spiritual healing of color chords after so many years of heavy political debate and corruption. Hard edge painting offered an impersonal clarity, sharp precision, and non-objective certainty that was welcomed after so many years of abstract expressionism's chaotic randomness. And it wasn't anything figurative, like that commie stuff. Manly American men thought figurative painting was good for the Saturday Evening Post and women's fashion magazines. High and mighty. In January of 1961, U.S. President Dwight Eisenhower gave a notable farewell address to the nation with his famous warning.
We must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
Later that month, when John F. Kennedy was sworn in as president, the majority of citizens in the U.S. and Europe felt inspired by his youthful charm, idealistic visionary support of the civil rights movement, and strong stance against the Soviet advancement, both across the world and in space.
I take pride in the words, Ich bin ein Berliner.
Photography had already proven itself to be the most important medium for capturing images that documented the unbelievable. The photo documentation of civil rights activists turned the attention of everyone to the toxic racism throughout the U.S. that many preferred to ignore. With Kennedy as president, it seemed that change could actually come. Several artists captured the shift in dynamic from old to young more than others, as well as the fascination that so many Americans shared with glamorous celebrities and heroic figures from popular culture, along with the consumer goods of everyday life that everyone loved and shared, both in America and across Europe. Pop art relished in turning the small treats in life, from soup, celebrities, hamburgers, and comics, into the larger-than-life dopamine explosions of visual gratification. While pop art had a distinctively different look than hard edge or color field painting, all of them share the absence of a personal brushstroke or gesture by the artist, which had been so prominent in abstract expressionism. Warhol's screen prints, combining the look of photographs with creative coloring, gave people the security of photographic objectivity fused with colorist fantasy, topped with the glamour of celebrity fascination.
Crazy.
Parallel to pop art, a different approach to art was flourishing, especially in New York City, one that also pronounced the out with the old, in with the new mindset. This form emphasized spontaneous interactions between people, art, and the environment. They were called happenings by Alan Kaprov and others because they blended elements of improv theater, performance, audience interaction, and artworks to make a new kind of creative experience that was different every time. Composers like John Cage were experimenting with unheard-of kinds of music using everyday objects as instruments. In Europe, similar experimental activities were taking place by other artists trying to push the boundaries of art. In 1960, Yves Klein produced Monotone Symphony, an orchestra playing one single D major chord with full force for 20 minutes, followed by 20 minutes of still-sitting silence as models painted canvases using their bodies as brushes with the artist's own signature and copyrighted International Klein Blue. Inspired by such artists as Jasper Johns and Robert Rauschenberg, in 1961, Nikki de St. Phalle fashioned a series of assemblages suspending bags of paint or cans of spray paint in front of white-painted constructions of diverse, symbolic objects. She would then repeatedly shoot the installation with a pistol or rifle, causing the liquids to bleed or spray out. In the name of love. In 1963, she started to explore the various roles of women with a series of figures that challenged stereotypical identities of women in society, such as the bride, the dutiful wife, the prostitute, the witch. In 1964, she started a prolific series of nanas that effectively embody the entire feminist movement of the 1960s. These nanas, large-scale and brightly colored sculptures of women, were voluptuous goddess-like creatures. Triumphant and larger than life, they are enduring emblems of maternity, femininity, and the independent woman. In 1966, in collaboration with Jean Tinguely and Per Olof Utvel, the ultimate nana was made, entitled She, a Cathedral, and it filled the entire exhibition hall in Stockholm.
A poet, it's a declaration.
Jean Tinguely himself had created a sensation in 1960, revolting against the sterile, static museum with his first large, self-destroying mechanical sculpture, Homage to New York. Tinguely's next self-destroying machine used a considerable amount of explosives to blow up. Remember, during this time, the threat of nuclear annihilation was constant throughout the Cold War era. Others, such as Edward Kienholz and George Segal, used unconventional materials in works that commented both subtly and savagely on racism, stereotypes, and social identities. Bridget Riley also broke with convention, along with her own representational art background, confronting perception through abstraction. She pared down her works to the essentials, initially by working only in black, white, and gray, along with designing minimal compositions with great dynamism. The viewer is just as important as the work itself. Time magazine later coined the term op art in 1964. This interest in a reduction to minimal elements grew over the course of the decade, even though it did not receive as much attention as other movements. But it makes sense. At every wild party, there will always be a few by themselves talking about aesthetic ideas.
I feel good.
Minimal art is not simplistic. Rather, it is a clearing away of everything thought to be superfluous. And during the consumerism of the 50s and 60s, there was a lot of extra baggage. One of the most unusual new ideas to come from their famous 1966 minimal art exhibit was the concept of artist as designer and not necessarily as maker.
Love can't do me no harm.
Other artists protested the over-the-top excess of the times and ruthless commercialization of art by developing landscape projects, often far away from any gallery scene. Land art, or earth art, reflected the growing environmental awareness of the times. Under the name Fluxus, an international community of artists, composers, designers, and poets engaged in experimental, interdisciplinary art events. The creative process was emphasized above the finished product. Individually, they had widely diverse interpretations, yet collectively, they held radical views about art and the role of art in society. Daniel Spyri made snare pictures, which took objects found in chance positions, such as the remains of food and dishes after a meal, and fixed them vertically. Eat art was served.
As the Manhattan telephone.
In 1963, Naim June Pike scattered televisions throughout a gallery and used magnets to alter or distort their images, beginning an exploration of unknown worlds of new media in what would soon be called video art. In 1964, Yoko Ono first performed Cut Piece, in which audience members were invited to become agents in the creation of art by approaching her one by one on stage and cutting off a small piece of her clothing. In 1965, Joseph Beuys performed How to Explain Pictures to a Dead Hare, with his face covered in honey and gold leaf, and with an iron slab attached to his boot causing him to limp and bang when he walked. He cradled the dead rabbit, mumbling noises into its ear along with explanations of the drawings that lined the walls. While the performance seemed absurd, every aspect had symbolic meaning. The subsequent conversations about these meanings were just as important, if not more important, than the work itself. Back in the States, the Back to the Roots folk music revival continued to protest for civil rights. In 64, the Beatles led the British invasion of the U.S. pop market. Refusing to play before segregated audiences in the South, they also smoked pot with Bob Dylan and soon tried LSD, which had already become a very popular counterculture drug, especially in San Francisco, fueling the psychedelic art of concert posters and album covers, which had largely been inspired by Art Nouveau. The long-term negative consequences of such drug use would manifest later as 1970s fashion styles. Yet at the time, such posters were out of this world.
Space.
Star Trek premiered in September 1966 as NASA scientists channeled their creative energy into achieving JFK's promise to put a man on the moon by the end of the decade. The 50s and 60s were tremendous for sci-fi literature and inspired an entire genre of cover illustrations. In 1968, Stanley Kubrick's epic sci-fi film 2001, A Space Odyssey, was released, a year before the first humans actually set foot on the moon, which conspiracy theorists promptly said was a hoax, filmed by Kubrick. As the late 60s became more and more extreme, many became very creative in finding new ways to break conventional taboos of behavior, shock society out of its conservative mindset, and become free of the past. In Austria, Viennese actionism led by Günter Brues, Otto Mull, Hermann Nietzsche, and Rudolf Schwarzkogler provoked so many scandals that all of them were imprisoned at some point, except for Rudolf Schwarzkogler, who mysteriously fell out of a window and died during, or after, a performance in 1969. Not to be outdone, others such as Valley Export and Peter Weibel took their art out onto the streets of Vienna. For example, when Valley took Peter for a walk on a leash, or when she invited random strangers to fondle her boobs as provocation. She is now regarded as a pioneer of media art and an international icon of the feminist avant-garde. Photo documentation continued to spread the awareness of the unbelievable among the uninitiated, letting young people see how many they were, not only at Woodstock and at peace movement demonstrations across the U.S., but also throughout Europe. And these young people could also see how older veteran radical reformers continued to protest against violence, poverty, and social injustice of all kinds. Dorothy Day and her Catholic worker movement refused to be intimidated as she and others would protest, often in creative ways that caught media attention, such as with the Bread and Puppet Theater, or publicly burning draft cards, a federal felony, thereby generating a change in public opinion. Often they would be arrested, be convicted, serve prison time, be released, soon to protest again and never give up. Their shared conviction, along with that of thousands of conscientious objectors and demonstrators, would shift public opinion against the Vietnam War and accelerate its end. Our own inner creative energy is our human superpower. And when we learn how to tap into it, we can then guide and release it in many different ways, from persuasive Friday for Future demos to rocket ships to Mars to viral videos. 1960s art reflects themes that have not yet been thoroughly resolved in our global society. They have just changed with the times, even as we have added a few more to the list. Fake news, energy sustainability, global pandemics, UFOs, to name a few. Yet looking back at the art of the 1960s, we can learn techniques that can help us, even without drugs, to access that inner creative force. So, when you are having one of those days that seems to be way more crazy and intense than others, relax and remember that if we as a species were able to get through the 1960s without blowing ourselves up, you can make it through this day too. So take care of yourselves and your gnathic mojo.